Non-Brits that visited the UK. What was the most unexpected thing you saw when here? Not the first time, but the second time I went to Britain was in the height of the Ulster Troubles when then Provisional IRA had started a bombing campaign on the English mainland. I had just started a job in London and I was on my way to work by London Tube to start my second day. At the Bank Tube station, the train was stopped and people requested to leave the train in the station as they had received a coded IRA bomb warning. As people left the train, the men made passage for the school children and then the women on the train to leave first. Then we all left. Nobody rushed. There was no panic. Men just quickly and quietly and politely left the train. Everyone walked to the exits. Nobody ran. No shouting. No moaning, just a quiet purpose. The escalators had been turned off and everyone quietly waited their turn to walk up the stairways and to the exits. At the exits, crowds had formed. Everyone waited. No pushing. No shoving. People patiently waited their turn. As we poured onto the street, car and van drivers were out of the cars shouting and offering lifts to people to help them get to work. Can take 4 to Whitechapel. Anyone for Farringdon. Covent Garden, anyone. And people just got on with getting to work. I have been on all 5 continents and worked and lived in more countries than most people will ever visit. Seeing the beguiling calm and resolve of the British under threat remains one of the most unforgettable. Of all the posts here, this really struck me. I think that some of it comes from the war, and also that stubborn refusal to display public emotion. Either way, I'm proud to be British. Thank you for sharing. It was more what I didn't see. I had just arrived from Australia in January. It was 8 a.m. on the train and it was pitch black. Sun not up. That was just insane to me. I'm a Brit in Oz and what freaks me out is the way the sun suddenly sets here. One moment there's a lovely orange sky and then boink. It's gone. How in the early hours of the morning, there was trash everywhere from everyone going out to the pubs. But by 9 a.m, everything was spotless again and beautiful. Wombles. My friend told me about his first day in England, where he saw a building on fire. He also saw 2 British people who were in a building nearby as they didn't call the fire station and rather walked away while exchanging witty comments about the burning building. That was his first impression. The assumption is that somebody would already have called the fire brigade, so all that can be done is trade witty banter and make sardonic jokes about it. This strikes me as a thoroughly English thing to do. See also, watching people fight after a car crash. I visited London in 2013, and I was surprised by all the places that had free Wi-Fi, as long as you had this odd type of account and account for the cloud. Thanks you Yachtscree for helping me remember the name. You could get Wi-Fi almost anywhere. Even the London I had it. Oh, and the tube. Contrary to the heck that you always rant about, my tube experience was quite pleasant. The trains ran intricately and smoothly. Disclaimer. Sorry, rest of the United Kingdom. Perhaps another time? I'm from Sydney. I was in London for a couple of days. It felt like I was in an Australian city I had never been to before, except this city was 1,000 years old and had castles and crap. Central Sydney felt like the bastard love child of London and Manhattan. Familiar, yet indescribably and unsettlingly different. That could have been the sun though. Beggars being so polite. Beggar, sorry to bother you sir, do you happen to have a spare 20p? Me, sorry mate, I don't. Beggar, not to worry, thanks anyway and have a nice night. What the heck, I was really taken back by this. Now I always just feel guilt walking through the town. The politeness is meant to make you feel guilty and thereby give them the change. Up my way they also say God bless after you say no change. Then you feel like a proper dong. The sideners. Holy cow. There are like 3-5 cider taps in every pub and they're all different from pub to pub. Old Rosie is like the nectar of the gods. That and the real ales. Oh good lord, I miss the real ales. Old Rosie. Things rapidly degenerate after 2 pints of that stuff. Foxes. What the heck? I'm from Australia and it was still weird to see animals prowling around your garbage. I have a fox I always run into on my evening jog. I tend to run alongside him past other people's gardens before he decides he's had enough of my crap and bolts. I went to use an ATM and it asked me if I would like an advice slip. This was pretty unexpected, because here in Norway an ATM will not do this. Obviously I pressed yes and looked forward to it. The machine printed a little piece of paper, which I assumed would say something like don't spend it all on candy, but it was just a receipt. Student studying in UK for a year. When it rains, nobody actually gave a frick about carrying an umbrella and they just continue to walk as if nothing happens. People actually go bonkers about sun coming out. In my own country, people who go on walks at 3 in the afternoon are either construction worker or wanting to be burned to death. Pub culture. It can be the middle of winter, but if the sun's out, you can guarantee someone will be going taps af. Everyone is freaking terrified of wasps and will run around flailing their hands wildly screaming in an attempt to anger the wasp. I think there's a common understanding in the UK that bees are fine but wasps are the devil. There was a Vietnamese restaurant operating near Piccadilly Circus late at night with a matter d' working the door as we were passing by. He grabbed my hand and said, I think this place is right for you. Come in. We walked in to find acoustic curtains and no furniture. There was a DJ spinning hardcore and the place was packed. Best surprise ever. Thank you, random Vietnamese man. Grabbed my hand. Terribly un-British. I visited in 1988 when I was 16. My brother was studying at Regent's Park College, which at the time was an international school. I grew up in the US suburbs, and this was a first trip outside the US. I flew by myself and my brother picked me up at Heathrow. I get to his college and first place we visit was a pub, which was in the college. This shocked me. A bar on college grounds. This isn't very common in America. Of course I'm 16 and excited to order beer. I walk up to the bar, and the bartender is the mirror freaking image of Rowan Atkinson. Now I watched BBC on our public TV stations, so I knew Monty Python, The Blackadder, Doctor Who and lots of other shows from Great Britain. I didn't know, at that time, Rowan Atkinson's name, just The Blackadder. So I say to the guy, hey, you look like The Blackadder. His reply, you look like a bucket of shite. Mildly mortified, I take my beers and go back to the table where my brother was sitting. Later that night my brother takes me to a dance club, Camden Palace, with some of his school friends. We take a taxi over and I'm the first one to step out, when a black fellow with dreadlocks walks right up to me. Now, again, context. I'm 16, from the suburbs, and some black dude who I don't know is coming at me. I'm getting robbed. Hey man, would you like to buy some hash? He asks very politely. Number, I reply. Oh, okay, well I will be right outside if you change your mind. He smiles and walks away. What nice drug dealers you have in London. I thought, that was basically my experience in London. I didn't even do anything touristy aside from get drunk for a week. You insulted him so he insulted you back. No one wants to look like Mr. Bean. D. I bet he has been getting that his whole life. This is the funniest thing I have read in ages. I thought England would be all posh accents and tea and crumpets. I stayed in South London and it reminded more of the hood where I'm from in the USA. Welcome to Peckham. The incredible amount of different flavors of chips, crisps, until I visited a UK supermarket, Tesco I think. I only knew salty, paprika and bolognese. D. It has changed over the last 10 years but we still don't have all the delicious UK flavors, like non-sweet and salt and vinegar. Ah, that's the doing of the Minister of Crisps Gary Lineker. Dad was in the US Navy and we moved from Cuba to England. That in and of itself was shocking. Spent my first year living in Bury St. Edmunds and took a bus from there to Feltwell for school. First off, they used coaches instead of the standard American school bus. Second, I could go get a shandy and look at the page 3 girl before I got on my bus. 13-year-old me freaking loved living in England. My most favorite memory is there was a sign leaving Scotland that said don't throw your trash here, throw it in England. Then when you got over the border there was a bunch of trash on the ground. Classic Scots. I first visited London when I was 16 in 1997. I'm from rural Ireland, the Sticks. My mother lived in London in the 60s and wanted to visit some of the places she lived and worked. We went to the Seven Sisters Road to have a look around. We were the only white people around. It was the biggest culture shock. rural Ireland in the 90s was 100% white, so to be the minority was a bit weird and scary for this country mouse. I've since been to the UK many times with work. You Brits are a lot like us but still different. And the orderly queues. So many queues. I'm always fascinated at how similar but different the UK and Ireland are. We're kind of like kids whose parents got divorced and they each raised one of us. Like The Parent Trap but with less Lindsay Lohan. I saw one of those Buckingham Palace guards sneeze. I'm pretty sure that's punishable by death by drawing and quartering. I asked one of them if I could pet his horse and he kind of looked at me in his peripheral vision. So I assumed he meant very well. The horse was very friendly. Then it sneezed directly into my face and the guard lost it. But tried to keep it together and just turned very red and teary-eyed. It was nice. So I went on my first overseas trip to London in my early 20s with my mum and sister. The bus from the airport was driven by a fellow Australian and a receptionist at the hotel was also Australian. I turned on the TV and found Neighbours on one channel and Home and Away on another. While I was wondering if the plane had accidentally turned around halfway, my sister was looking out the window watching a woman being mugged on the street. But definitely not the overseas experience I was expecting. Frick, they're leaking back in. I'm Italian and my main experience with Brits before I visited the UK were ghostly, pale, constantly shirtless people who turned bright red after a few days. The UK was surprisingly multicultural. Nobody is afraid of the massive flocks of pigeons in London. How are you not afraid of all of those pigeons? Edit. Didn't know about the seagulls. Now I can never go back. If you find the pigeons scary, just wait until you see the seagulls, especially the ones in Scotland. I once saw a seagull eat a pigeon here. I've been in London a few times and one thing that always amuses me is the various knockoffs of Kentucky Fried Chicken. Basically random Southern State Fried Chicken. Rather few actual KFCs. Quite a common thing all over the UK. My neck of the woods is Ken's Fried Chicken with a suspiciously familiar red and white color scheme. Footlong Subway with drink for £5. So cheap compared to Norway, felt like I was in heaven. Also, vinegar crisps. My soul hated me for eating that one in our hotel room. When people say the UK is cheap, then you know they are paying serious dough. I'm 19. Didn't really surprise me when I was there, but when I got back to the US I walked up to a bar, sat down, and then remembered, oh crap, I'm not 21. First night in London, walk in the foggy desolate streets at night, and at street corners are groups of round orb-like lights, almost floating, shining and blinking. Looked so surreal that I thought that I was in some kind of art installation. Turns out they were lights for crossing the street. The crosswalk signs telling you which way to look. I love that tourists must have caused so many accidents that London decided to shell out money to literally tell them which way to look. They are everywhere. Not just London. We have a lot of one-way streets and unusual junctions due to us not having grid civil planning. As a pedestrian, there's very often little indication of which way traffic should be driving in these places, so the floors are marked. I'm so late but hopefully someone sees this. I'm an American who studied abroad for 4 months in England. Three things. 1. The North-South divide. 2. That the refrigerator and dishwasher in my host family's home looked like the rest of the cabinets. 3. That for traditional weddings the men wear morning coats and top hat. The real problem is when you're from the Midlands and Southerners won't accept that you're anything other than Northern. I was just there about 2 weeks ago. 1. That when I see a price in a store, I pay exactly the price listed. 2. Let me qualify this next statement by saying I'm from San Diego. Beach huts. Why would you want to take ownership of lease a small room that you can't even sleep in, by the beach? I just moved to the UK 2 weeks ago because uni, and here's what I experienced so far. A bacon sandwich is freaking legendary. Tea with milk so good. For the most unexpected part is that people are overall incredibly friendly and open-minded. Except agencies and chavs, is what they call them if I'm correct. I'll be broke af by the end of the month. After years of hearing how bad English food was, I was very surprised to find that it not only was not bad, some of it was really good. Not just talking about fish and chips either. Sunday roast, bangers and mash, Yorkshire pudding. The cliché of British food being bad was because of rationing during and immediately after World War II, when it genuinely was bad. First of all, I love the UK. Two things I was not aware of. One, that you really measure in mph, was there by bike and everybody honked the horn. Two, that your girls wear not much when they party, whatever weather it is. Love this about the UK. Went to St. Paul's Cathedral. I was of course amazed by the architecture, the sculptures, and the various pieces of art and history, but I did not expect that, behind the church's high altar, is an area entirely dedicated to the US as thanks for their alliance in World War II, the American Memorial Chapel. It's beautiful and deeply reverent. Kept in a glass case, there's a massive tome that lists the names of every American soldier, sailor, and marine stationed in the UK who died in the war. Signs telling me that I had to pay more to eat in. Mate, what the frick is that crap? Like, this is why we started our own country, with blackjack and convicts. It's something to do with VAT. It's not a luxury to eat when you are walking, so they don't pay tax. But if you are eating and you are using their services and it becomes a luxury, so VAT is added. Or, you know, the company is just greedy. The passion for football. I had read Buford's Among the Thugs and knew the English were somewhat crazy about the sport, but until I experienced myself I had no idea. I was in Bournemouth the 24th of June, 2004, Euro Cup quarterfinals, England v Portugal. I figured it would be a good idea to go see the game. I went to the biggest, busiest looking pub in the area. Folks had face paint, St. George flag capes, the whole nine yards. During the game, the locals accepted me as the American who doesn't know crap. Overall, I was treated well. With a 2-2 final score, out came the OT penalty kicks. The whole place groaned. Adult men were weeping. I didn't understand why. We still had a chance. It was explained that England always loses in penalty kicks. Always. I had never seen such cynicism. I told my table to buck up, stay positive. They told me to STFU, and somehow, true to its nature, the English side blew it. Beckham himself puffed his kick way over the bars. A schoolgirl could have done better. As the Portuguese on the TV celebrated, the pub turned dark and evil. Sadness turned to rage in a millisecond. Young men tore off their England capes and started throwing things. It was time for the American to GTFO. But as I spilled into the street, there was nowhere to go. The angry crowd marched up the street in a huge block. I was carried along like a loose thread. At the top of the street, the police had formed a cordon. There were police cars blocking the street and uniformed cops, each with a truncheon, ready to bust some skulls. As I was pulled up the hill with the crowd, some young men started screaming invective at the police. The police just tapped their truncheons in their palms, ready, waiting. Just as I was sure the crowd would attack and police would start bashing skulls, mine included, I'm sure, the young drunk vanguard collapsed. Rather than face the police head on, they calmed down and filtered through the cordon, mumbling nasty words and staring at the cops. I gleefully pardoned my way through the crowd and the cops and made a beeline back to my BNB. I've seen some upset folks at sports bars in America, but I had never seen what Buford described as it going off. Holy crap, England. It's just a freaking game. Chill out. Mate, you're so lucky you didn't say that out loud. American here. I live in New Jersey. I visited Northern Ireland. What amazed me was the clear division between Catholics and Protestants. Then, I thought about it. We do the same thing with blacks versus whites. Also, kids start school at 9 a.m. They eat breakfast with their parents. No rush. Life was so lackadaisical there overall. It completely lacked the rush of the Tree State area. There was also a contentness of life. Few people seemed stuck in the rat race of life. I love just random castles just off the highway. I was raised on Disney, and when I saw my first castle in Ireland I dang had an orgasm. Also, y'all's get 6 weeks off of vacation, and the whole dang country takes vacation at once? Woozers. 8/10 would vacation and possibly live there in the future again. how well dressed everyone is compared to North America. Sure, you got your chavs and such, but it's not on the scale of over here. I went to university with a lot of Americans. You could spot them a mile off. Nobody else would wear mom jeans, New Balances and navy fleece jackets. Such a low amount of trash bins. I was in the historical center of London and had to stack all my trash in my backpack until we got back to our hotel. I think it partly due to the IRA having a habit of putting bombs in bins during the Troubles, but bins are slowly making a comeback. Chips, chips everywhere. They're not fries. There's different about them from American French fries. They're freaking delicious. 2. Is it the oil? Do potatoes just taste different there? I dunno. But I don't even like fries that much. I am American that studied at Falmouth in Cornwall for 3 years, and I have to say it's the little things that stuck out. Greeting people with, "You all right?" Palm trees. Top up utility bills with a USB stick. Chav culture. I still avoid anyone wearing Burberry, Welsh accents, the pronunciation of vitamin, and how you say David Bowie. CCTV cameras everywhere. Christmas crackers with the weird paper crown. Seeing a Boots pharmacy 15 feet from historic churches. Washing machines in the kitchen. The amount of feral cats, though that may just be Cornwall. How good the food was. I'd punch a toddler for a Cornish pasty. Squash. I still find that weird. Also, that beverage is a 99% ice free. Page 3 girls. The amount of celebrity panel shows. I do love QI, though. Boot sales. Spelling it as tire. The ubiquity of electric kettles. There's a lot more, but I have to say it is one of my favorite countries in the world, and I'd be back in a heartbeat. The ubiquity of electric kettles. The entire national grid was built around everyone having a cuppa. Chip butties. The first time I saw someone proceed to put chips on their butted white bread, my thought process went something like, but you can't. I am more used to it now, but I still wouldn't eat one. Just do it, with a bit of ketchup. It is amazing. I tried one of your awful peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. It's only fair if you do a chip sarnie. The night I arrived in London at Heathrow, there was a man with clear mental issues yelling obscenities at everyone and screaming that he was looking for his mother. The airport security police came by and dealt with him extraordinarily gently and compassionately, which was a particularly stark contrast to how the situation would have gone down in an American airport. What is Pret a Manger and why do I see it on every freaking street I see? I ask locals about it and they're like, oh yeah, they're pretty common, but seriously, they're everywhere. Football games are fun and the fans are really friendly. One of the best sports experiences I've ever had. And I really don't follow soccer in the US. I've never been in the snow up until then. Accepted a dare to run for 2 minutes in about a foot and a half of snow in just underwear. Never again. I lived in Leighton for 2 years, and I would say seeing Muslim women in full body burqa shopping at Asda surprised me the first time. Then I got used to it. If you are new to the channel, you can subscribe. I publish new videos every day. Until then, check another video. Bye for now.